Today. Just want to remind you that on Wednesday at 7 p.m. on Facebook Live is Exploring the Bible with Pastor Mike and Charlene. And our topic this week, we didn't get to it last week because we had and we're going to be picking up on Who is the Holy Spirit Part 2. And let's find out together what God says. Not what people say. Not what Satan tells us, not something we heard, but Amen. Something we know because God said it.
Yes.
So we encourage you to ask questions or leave comments when we're on Wednesday, and we would so appreciate that. We've been getting a lot of great feedback, so we're happy that this is helpful to others. And then on Friday at 7 p.m. on Zoom, we have the Young Adult and Children's Bible Study. We hadn't had it for the last 2 weeks for the simple fact that some of the kids were not able to get on. So we're going to get back this week and have a great time with the Young Adult and Children's Bible Study. And I also want to remind everyone of our Rebuild, Renovate, and Restore fundraiser. We have extended it until March 1st. In fact, it might go a little bit even further than that. Might have to push it to April 1st because in April, once this weather breaks, a lot of great things are going to be occurring at Palmer Road Baptist Church on starting to restore our building. And we want to thank all of you, of course, for your continued support of Palmer Road Baptist Church because we are just so blessed at what God is getting ready to do. And unfortunately, we're going to have to reopen. We're going to have to push it up another 2 weeks until March 20th. Unfortunately, Friday I had a car accident, and we don't have a vehicle right at this moment until it gets repaired or we're able to get another vehicle. But as any of you know that's in a car accident, it takes time to get, you know, the claims done and to get the insurance company on it and find a place to put it in to get it repaired or whatever they're going to do. So that will take place next week. And again, due to the pandemic, a lot of things have slowed down, so I'm not sure how long it's going to take. But God willing, He will speed up the process for us. In the meantime, we just want you to stay encouraged, Palmer Road Baptist Church, because God has great things that are going to happen. Amen. We just need to keep remaining faithful to the Lord. So we're going to open up in song. One of these song that we're going to play today is called Jireh. And Jireh means, in the Hebrew language, it means God the provider. And one thing that Pastor Mike and I have really recognized is that God has provided us every step of the way. And even though right now we are without a vehicle, He's going to provide a means of us being able to do what we still need to do. So we're so thankful to Him. And as we open up in this song to praise and worship Him, remember, God is your provider. All right.
can do to let you down. Doesn't take a trophy to make you cry. I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Going through a storm, but I won't be worn down. I hear your voice carrying the rhythm of the wind to call me out. You would cross an ocean.
Okay.
that song. It speaks so much about how God truly is enough for all of us. So we have a couple of praises today. One of them being is that Chase will be getting fitted for glasses on April 20th so that he can see better. So we praise the Lord for that.
Amen.
Also, Velma and Shorty Hammond have recovered from their bout with COVID, and they're coming along fine. We praise the Lord for that.
Amen.
We also praise the Lord that I was in a head-on collision, but myself and Julian came out okay. Got a little soreness, but other than that, we came out okay. So we give God praise for that, because that could have been a lot worse, and the other driver was okay also. We also want to lift up in prayer, of course, the people who are involved in the war with Russia and Ukraine and all of that that's going on over there. We pray for the safety, because there's over, 200,000 Jewish Christians that live in Ukraine. And we want to really pray for them, also the Christians that are there. And of course, anybody that's going through war, we want to pray for. We know that it's a horrible thing that's going on, and you know, unfortunately, it comes right to Matthew 24, where it says wars and rumors of wars. This is where we're at today, folks.
Amen.
So we know that things have to come to pass, because if it didn't, then that means that God's word is not true. So let's just keep them up in prayer. We also want to keep up Bill and Pat Meyer. A woman named Liz with blood cancer, who is also battling with some effects of COVID. We want to keep her up in prayer. A gentleman named Sean, his wife, who's only, I think, 41 years old, in great health, all of a sudden found out that she needs a heart transplant. She's in the hospital right now, and we want to just pray for them that God will see her through. Also, we want to lift up Christy and Joe Gentner and their family for some things that they're going through. Jim McKinney, Scott and Jessica Tackerberry and her family, Sherry Cox, Cassie and Perry Dudonis and their family, Dustin Foster, Dorian Foster, Pastor Quincy and her family, Alicia Spencer, Joan Spencer. We want to continue to pray for Pomeroy Baptist Church and all of our members and their families. Galatian Christian Church, Pastor Willie and Evangelist Mary Cleveland, Pastor Stan and First Lady Lynetta Sargent of New Life in Christ Ministries. We want to lift everyone up in prayer today. Some of them are having serious health problems. Some of them are getting ready to lay one of their family members to rest this coming week. We want to keep them up in prayer. Also, pray for Pastor Mike and myself that we get some work done on this car and see what we can get going this week, and that God will find favor with us, that we can get things moving along swiftly. And, you know, again, we not only when we bring others up in prayer, we want to keep in mind that that we have to have faith, that we believe that God's going to bring things about for people, because we're actually interceding on others on their behalf that are weak because of physical ailments, or maybe weak in their faith. But you know, the great thing about the Lord is that where two or more are gathered in His name, He is there in the midst, and we know this. So let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we come to You. First of all, we're praising You for all the things that You've brought us through this week. And Lord, you know, things happen, and sometimes we question why, but Lord, You know what the answer is. And Lord, we're just thankful that with the car accident, that Julian and I came out okay, and so did the other driver, and nobody was seriously hurt. So Lord, we thank You for that. Lord, we thank You for Velma and Shorty being able to get over COVID, Lord. And we're thankful that they're on the mend and they're doing well. And Lord, we're thankful for what you're doing for Chase. And Lord, we're so thankful that he'll be able to see even that much more, Lord, as you continue to heal his brain. And Lord, we lift up all the people that were mentioned today, Lord. We especially lift up Bill and Pat Meyer, Lord. You know their struggles right now, Lord. And Lord, we know that you have Bill in your hands, Lord, right now. And Lord, we'd ask that today that you would give him some comfort, Lord, within his physical body. And Lord, that you would bring him forth once more, Lord, and that he would be able to be focused, Lord, that he's waiting, Lord, for you to call him home. But Lord, we know that you're still preparing that place for him, Lord. So we, Lord, just ask that you be with his wife as she continues to care for him, Lord, that you would give her the strength that she needs. And Lord, we lift up those that are suffering with cancer today, Lord, that you would give them comfort throughout their body, Lord, and whatever it is that they are struggling with, Lord, within their physical bodies. And Lord, again, we just give you all the praise, Lord, for the things that you continue to do for us, Lord, despite ourselves. Lord, that is the great and amazing thing about you, that great is your faithfulness, Amen. Lord, to us. Yes. So, Lord, we just give you all the praise and glory. In Jesus' yes. name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. So our next song, you know, we played it quite a bit, but, you know, I just think that it is one of the greatest songs, especially for today, because we all need a blessing today, don't we?
Yes, amen.
And the way that this particular song is that it's talking about how God told Moses how to praise the Israelites of what to say to bless them. So as we bring this song, just keep in mind that this is a prayer that Pastor Mike and I have for all of you, and also for ourselves, because we so need God's blessings today, don't we?
Amen.
All right, so let's yes. get started Amen. With that, and then Pastor Mike will come and say a few words before the message.
The Lord said to Moses, "Tell Aaron and his sons, this is how you are to bless the Israelites. Say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. So they will put my name on the Israelites and I will bless them. Tonight we speak the blessing of Almighty God over you, your church, your city, your family, your children, and their children, for 1,000 generations, in the name that is above every other name, the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you.
to everyone out there that's listening in or watching us on YouTube or Facebook. May God continue to bless you. I want to read from the book of Psalms, chapter 139, verses 1 through 5. The Lord had given me this scripture this very moment. I'm going to share with you this before Charlene comes up and gives a message today. In your King James, it starts off by saying, "Thou hast searched my heart and know me." But I'm going to read from the New Living Translation so you can understand the fullness of what this is telling you today. O Lord, you have examined my heart and know everything about me. Amen. You know when I sit down or when I stand up.
Yes.
You know my thoughts even when I am far away. You see me when I travel and when I am at rest at home. And you know everything I do. You know that what I'm going to say even before I say it, Lord. You go before me and follow me, and you place your hand of blessings upon my head.
Yes.
I want you to think about that.
Amen.
The writer of this psalm says, Lord, you have searched my heart. You know me. You know everything about me. And so today, I want you to recognize that God is searching your heart. He searches it every day. And it's very vital and important, especially today, because we are moving into a whole new phase.
Yes.
We are in, if you don't realize yet, we are in the last days here.
Yes.
I'm not a prognosticator. I'm not prophesying when. I don't know. The scripture tells us that no one knows. But we are on the verge of the return of Christ today.
Yes.
My question to you, are you ready?
I'm ready.
It's important to recognize where you are at. Yes. If you don't know, you ask God, Lord, reveal to me where I am. We all want to live forever with him, but there's a requirement. We have to know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior.
Yes.
And we also have to live that life according to the word of God. So think about this. Pray about this and really respond. Lord, as you search my heart, bring me to the place where I can be obedient to you. Bring me to a place, Lord, where I'm close to you.
Yes.
Because we're moving into time, Lord. God, I don't know what to do. I have fears. I'm afraid. I see things that are happening today in the world. And right now, Lord, my ground that I stand on is unstable.
Yes.
But I know, Lord God, if you are my foundation, my rock, I can go through everything and anything that comes my way.
Yes.
I don't want to preach a message here right now, but I just want to share that with you. As I remove myself out of the way, I call forth Minister Charlene, and she's about to share a great message with you today. May God bless her and bless you.
Thank you, Pastor Mike, for that. You know, Pastor Mike had no idea what I was going to speak about today. But the title of my message is, How Safe Am I? You know, as we're going through all these turmoils in life, what's going on within the world itself, we need to really be confident that we are, those of us that know Jesus Christ, those of us that have a relationship with Him, have to know beyond all doubt that we are safe with Him. And you know, brings to mind that, you know, those security systems in homes that you have where you have to punch in the code you know, to turn them on or off when you're going out or coming back in. We had at one time at our old home that it would go off if you didn't punch the code, and it was really loud and annoying. But we knew it worked because it was loud, and it alerted us that, hey, somebody was coming in the door. And then you have those systems where you have people that are monitoring constantly.
Mm-hmm.
Well, supposedly they're monitoring constantly. And if your alarm goes off, they promise that they're going to send help immediately. But how do we really know? How do we really know that they're watching and that if they hear it, that they're going to send someone immediately? You know, sometimes I said, well, you know, it would be fun to go ahead and punch the code in just to see how fast they would actually get here in case there was really trouble. But, you know, unless I wanted to get into deep trouble doing it, I just had to trust and believe that God, or that they were going to come out, right? So I feel much the same way when I read Psalms 91. Psalm 91 is one of the most eloquent and picturesque about how he speaks of the provisions of security in the Lord. So if you would turn with me to Psalm 91, and I'm going to read it out of the King James Version, but as I break down each verse, it will be in the New Living Translation. But starting with verse 1, and we're going to read all the way to 16, and I want you to really listen to what the psalmist says. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. Verse 4, he shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh into darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh unto thee. Verse 8, only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation.
Amen.
There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh unto thy dwelling, for he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. Thou shalt bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Verse 14, because he hath set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high because he hath known my name. He shall call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. Verse 16, with long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation.
Amen.
Wow, what a song.
Amen.
In verses 3 through 13, we see first what God gives. That's the great thing. We see what God gives. The first provision God gives us in verse 3 is surely he will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. So what does that mean? Well, the fowler's snare is a trap set to catch prey.
Come on.
It symbolizes danger from the enemy. It means that God gives safety from the traps and snares the devil, what the devil sets for us.
Come on.
And we can go back to this car accident that I was just involved in. Even though the car got destroyed, we were still intact. The devil didn't win on that one. Did not win on that. And it means that God gives safety from the traps and snares the devil sets for us. In the Lord's Prayer, we do pray, Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Amen.
And this provision is the reason why we can ask with confidence. God also provides shelter.
Yeah.
Wow. This is all in Psalm 91, what God gives us. He gives us shelter. In the first part of verse 4, he will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge. Bird experts say that the spreading of wings with birds is very common. And what happens when a predator or something dangerous approaches? The bird instinctively spreads its wings, and the younger birds scurry underneath for shelter. Wow.
Amen.
This is what God gives us.
What a God we serve.
So it provides a beautiful image, which is why it is so frequent throughout the Bible. You know, it speaks a lot about, we can go to Deuteronomy 32:11. He was like an eagle hovering over its nest, overshadowing its young, then spreading its wings, lifting them into the air, teaching them to fly.
Hmm.
This is what God does for us. Psalm 36:7, how priceless is your unfailing love, O God. People take refuge in the shadow of your wings. Psalm 57:1, have mercy on me, my God. Have mercy on me, for in you I take refuge. I will take refuge in the shadow of your wings until the disaster has passed.
Praise God.
Even Jesus used the image. Even Jesus did. In Matthew 23:37, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones God's messengers. How often I have wanted to gather your children together as a hen protects her chicks beneath her wings.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. That's what Jesus said in Matthew 23:37 in the New Living Translation. So when the storms of life are whipping and whirling around us, which we see a lot today,
amen,
God will deliver us. He will shelter us. So God's third provision is that he is our shield. He's our shield. And the funny thing is, this is only in the first four verses. He's our shield. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. The psalmist knew that God is faithful to all he created.
Amen.
And 36:5, your love, Lord, reaches to the heavens, your faithfulness to the skies. He knew that God's faithfulness would pass through the generations.
Mm.
Wow. Isn't that something great? Psalm 119:89-91, your eternal word, O Lord, stands firm in heaven. Did you hear that? Your eternal word stands firm in heaven. Your faithfulness extends to every generation, as enduring as the earth you created. Your regulations remain true to this day, for everything serves your plans. There are times when only the faithfulness of God can give us hope. Wow. Only the faithfulness of God can give us hope. Lamentations 3:20-23. I will never forget this awful time as I grieve over my loss. Yet I still dare to hope when I remember this. The faithful love of the Lord never ends. His mercies never cease.
Yes.
Great is his faithfulness. His mercies begin afresh each morning. God's faithfulness is our shield. Wow.
Amen.
And that was just in the first four verses. God provides safety, shelter, a shield, and get this, sacred guardians. Sacred guardians. For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so they will not strike your foot against a stone.
Wow.
You believe that? He also sends us sacred guardians.
Mm.
Hebrews 1:14 teaches us that angels are ministering spirits sent to serve those who will inherit salvation. And you know, I didn't even know that was in the scripture. Didn't even know that was in the scripture. God sends his angels to keep us safe and on track in all our ways. In essence, God has provided us with designated drivers to escort us home. Amen. God graciously gives us tremendous provisions. And the psalmist shows us that we gain.
Amen.
First, we gain freedom from fear. Ooh, how many of you want freedom from fear? Verses 5 and 6. You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. Since God provides security, what is there to fear? The psalmist also says that we gain freedom from evil. Ooh, hallelujah. Freedom from evil. Verses 7 and 8. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only observe with your eyes, and you'll see the punishment of the wicked. Wow. Won't that be an awesome sight? You know, those people that are just, they're just so evil that you just can't believe that the things that go on today in the world. But we will be able to see that with our eyes of what the Lord's going to do to those that are wicked. Evil will not take over our lives and control us. Though 10,000 are dying around me, the evil will not touch me. I will see how the wicked are punished, but I will not share in it. Wow. Look at that. Thirdly, we gain freedom from harm and disaster. Verse 10, no harm will overtake you, no disaster will come to your tent. God gives us safety, shelter, a shield, and sacred guardians, so we are free from fear, evil, and harm and disaster. In fact, the psalmist concludes by restating God's covenant with us in verses 14 through 16. What will God do? I will rescue him. I will protect him. For he acknowledges my name.
All right.
He will call on me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. Wow. God will not only deliver us, he will honor us. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. Notice that the promises, God will rescue us, protect us, answer our prayers, be with us, deliver us, honor us, satisfy us with long life, and show us salvation. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
That went back to the song, The Blessing. That's what God will do for us, those of us that know him. But let me ask you something. Because I talk to a lot of people, and sometimes I scratch my head and say, do you really believe it? Do you really believe that God's going to be able to do these things for you? Because to never be fear, to never worry or wonder. What about Christians who die at a young age, who are killed by drunk drivers, who are murdered because they're in the wrong place at the wrong time, who are killed simply because they believe in Jesus? And that, my friends, is going on very strong today. Who have children born with malformations or disease, whose marriages break apart, who lose everything through a fire or a natural disaster, who contract cancer that keeps eating away at their bodies. How can we say we believe this psalm in the light of the reality of life? How can we make sense of what we know we should believe in light of the seeming contradictions that life brings? The key lies, I think, in this psalm, in the place of security. In verses 1 through 2, whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust.
Amen.
So notice that whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High, the place of security, the place of security is dwelling in the shelter. The verb to dwell means to remain, stay, tarry, endure, have one's abode. It suggests continuance and permanence.
That's right. Amen.
The shadow of God is not the occasional resort, but the constant abiding place of the saint. We ought never to be out of the shadow of God, because it is to dwellers, not to visitors.
All right.
Wow. Mm. It is to dwellers, not to visitors, that the Lord promises his protection. The reality is that many of us run to the shelter for a visit, but we don't stay there. Mm-hmm. We run to the shelter in times of trouble or need or fear, but they dwell somewhere else.
Right now.
Wherever it is not the shelter of the Almighty. As Isaiah prophesied in chapter 55, verses 2 through 3, why spend your money on food that does not give you strength? Why pay for food that does you no good? Listen to me, and you will eat what is good. You will enjoy the finest food. Come to me with your ears wide open. Listen, and you will find life. I will make an everlasting covenant with you. I will give you all the unfailing love that I promised David. Wow. Mm. Dwelling in the shelter produces a blessing. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. The imagery conveyed in the shadow of the Almighty comes from the Holy of Holies, which is in the tabernacle and the temple.
Yes.
In the Holy of Holies, two cherubims were over the mercy seat, and their wings touched each other. Under his wings, in the shadow, means at the mercy seat. Wow, you hear that? Mm-hmm. What David was talking about, where the blood was sprinkled in the presence of the glory of God. The mercy seat points us to Jesus. Our dwelling, in other words, is to be with Jesus. In fact, Jesus identifies his disciples as those who abide or dwell in him through his eating of his flesh and drinking his blood. John 6:56. They also dwell in his word. John 8:31. And above all else, they dwell in him as branches would dwell or abide in the vine. John 15:7-8. This abiding life, to live and remain in Jesus, is the New Testament counterpart to the dwelling in the shelter of the Most High. Wow. So even from the Old Testament to the New Testament, it's the counterpart of dwelling in the Most High. And that is when you are a disciple of Christ, and when you are a Christian and you've accepted Christ into your life, that means that you now have the promise of being able to shelter under the wings of the Lord. Wow. So our rest comes from being in Jesus. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. Jesus puts it this way, Matthew 11:28. Come to me, all ye who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. The psalm points us to Jesus. We see him in Gethsemane pleading, please take this cup from me. We hear him at the cross crying out, Father, why have you forsaken me? Yet we also hear him say, Father, into your hand I commit my spirit. He trusted, and the evil did not overtake him.
Amen.
It knocked him down, but he rose up victorious.
Yes. Yes.
Are you willing in the midst of tough times of life to put your weight and trust in God? Are you willing to be able to be knocked down, but rise up victorious through Jesus Christ? Mm. Oh, I so hope we all get to this marvelous place of fully trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ. For times are going to get a lot tougher. Things are moving so fast for the triumphant victory of his return. And look around. Those of you who know the scripture can see that his word is just flying right off of the pages. So let's be confident and know this, that Jesus is who he said he is, our strong and mighty tower. So how safe are we in the Lord today? We are abundantly safe. And I want to leave you with this. This is a conversation between God and a person. We can say it's between God and myself. So I say, God, can I ask you something? God says, sure. Promise you won't get mad? He says, I promise. Why do you let so much stuff happen to me today? He says, well, what do you mean? First of all, I woke up late. Yes. My car took forever to start. Okay. At lunch, they made my sandwich wrong and I had to wait. On the way home, my phone went dead just as I picked up a call. All right. And to top it all off, when I got home, I just wanted to soak my feet in my foot massager and relax, but it wouldn't work. Nothing went right today. Why did you do that to me? And to top it all off, when I got home, I'm sorry, well, let me see, he says. The death angel was at your bed this morning. God's saying this. And I had to send one of the other angels to battle him for your life. I let you sleep through that. Oh. I didn't let your car start because there was a drunk driver on our route that might have hit you when you were on the road. Oh. The first person who made your sandwich today was sick and I didn't want you to catch what they had. And I knew you couldn't afford to miss work. Your phone went dead because the person that was calling was going to give you a false witness about what you said on that call. So I didn't even let them talk to you so that you would be covered. I see, God. Oh, and that foot massager? It had a short that was going to throw out all the power in your house last night. I didn't think you wanted to be in the dark. I'm sorry, God. No, don't be sorry. Just learn to trust me in all things, the good and the bad. I will trust you, God. And don't doubt that my plan for your day is always better than your plan. I won't, God, and just let me tell you, God, thank you for everything today. You're welcome, child. It's just another day being your God, and I love looking after my children. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him I trust. So I just ask you today that without everything that's going on, that you refer to Psalm 91 if you need to know that God is our safety. How safe are we today? Oh, we are abundantly safe according to His word. We just have to believe that within ourselves. So I thank you for joining us today, and I hope that this gave you some encouragement. To know that God is with us always, and that all we have to do is trust and believe, because each situation we see with that little conversation that no matter what happens with us, God always has a better plan for us in place. You know, I can question all day long, God, why did you let me get into an accident? Why don't we have a vehicle? I could go on and get all bummed out over everything, and but you know what? God has proven to me over and over again that I don't need to worry, that all I have to do is trust in Him. Is it aggravating? Oh, you better believe it. Is it annoying? Oh, you better believe that. But this I know, Satan has come at us with every way that he can, but we are still going to rise up. Amen. And have the victory through Jesus. Amen. Christ our Lord. Palmer Road Baptist Church, I want you to know that. We are going to rise up and have a victory in the Lord Jesus Christ. Because let me tell you, once this weather breaks and things are going to happen. Amen. Some great and mighty things are going to happen. So stay encouraged.
Praise God.
Yes. All right. Amen.
Thank you, Minister Charlene, what a message. I hope you heard what the Lord was saying today. He did not say nothing would happen to you. Mm-hmm. The Bible tells us many are the trials of the righteous, but God will deliver them out of them all. You know, over and over again, I've talked to people and understand what I'm saying. I have respect, but not fear of this COVID. What I mean by this, I'm not going to tempt God and do something stupid. If it's calling for us to wear a mask, I will wear my mask. Not out of fear, but out of respect.
Yes.
I don't want to tempt God. put God in a situation where I'm acting like nothing can harm me. But you know what? Everyone in our household, from our youngest grandson, Chase, who's 5 years old, until myself, I'm a little bit older than five, so you figure that out. We all got COVID. But we understood that we are under the protection of God, yes, under yes, his wings.
Yes.
And so, if God was going to call us home, then so be it.
Yeah.
But my thing was, we did not shut down. We kept moving forward.
Yes.
We opened up on Wednesday Bible study.
Yes.
And Pastor, excuse me, let me say this again. Minister Charlene continued to work with the children on Friday. On Sunday, we brought you our services. We did what God told us to do in spite of the fact that Satan wanted to bring us down to shut the show down.
Yes.
And even today, I'm wearing some normal work clothes. Why? Because at 12 noon, we were appointed to be somewhere to help someone else out. But Satan had stopped trying to stop another situation. Our son Dustin, his vehicle won't start right now. He's trying to get that vehicle started so we can get to the job to finish up. But you see what he's trying to do. He's trying to stop this whole thing from going forward. We have joined together with Faith Works to be an assistance and blessing to those and within our community.
Yes.
And so Satan wants to stop that from going forward.
But he's not going to happen.
But it's not going to happen. We're still going to get this thing done.
Yes. Amen.
And I want you to recognize that if you know him, if you truly know him, God has a responsibility towards you. When things come upon you, he will bring you out of the thing for victory.
Yes. Amen.
So thank you, Minister, for sharing that great word with us. I hope it has encouraged you today. Why don't we bow our heads as we go to the Lord and pray? Our great and mighty God, we thank you today. We thank you for your comfort. We thank you for your provisions. We thank you for your shelter. We thank you for your blessings. We yes. thank you for all things you have given us.
Yes.
You have given us a great testimony. Because how can you tell somebody that God is a healer if you've never been sick?
Yes.
How can you tell somebody that God is a motivator if you've never been down and out?
Yes.
How can you tell someone that God can bring you out of darkness into light if you've never been in darkness?
Yes.
I want to tell you today, as we continue to pray, put your trust in him no matter what you go through. Father, there are some out there that are struggling with their faith.
Yes.
They feel the fear before they look to you for an answer.
Yes.
You are the solution to our problems.
Yes.
Cause us to look up to the hills which cometh our help, because our help cometh from the Lord,
yes.
the creator of heaven and earth.
Yes.
We thank you, God, for opening the door for us. We know, God, that you will continue to bless us as long as we continue to do what you tell us to do.
Yes.
May God bless you and restore you and encourage you and keep you.
Yes.
Thank you for being here with us today. Let's hear what you thought about our message today that was brought to you by a servant of the Lord, Minister Charlene. May God bless you. Amen.
Amen.